Okay, so we get to have fun today and not have to prove any theorems. See how everything works. So the goal is to explain a little bit of the story of operator algebras and then explain how it's actually telling you all about physics. So let's just start off with some definitions. So a Banach algebra it's not so surprising, it's an algebra which is also a Banach space. It's got a norm, it's complete with respect to the norm, and the two things should interact in some way, and the pretty sensible way in which they can interact is that the norm of a product of two elements of the algebra should be at most the product of the norms. Okay, so we need some examples, and the example that absolutely works everywhere through here is B of H, and in fact everything we'll talk about today will be a Banach algebra. Hopefully that's all obvious to B of H. Just a sort of non-example, or rather, so this isn't an example, it's an example of a Banach space. Here you can just use the usual sort of operator norm, which just means the absolute value of the largest eigenvalue or whatever. For this guy, it still satisfies this property, of course, because this is just a subalgebra of two by two matrices, so it's a subalgebra of one of these. But this one won't be any of the later sorts of algebras we talk about. Banach algebras really are awful. What I mean is, we can define the spectrum, sigma of A, and it's a subset of the complex numbers, and it's just our usual definition of the spectrum, it's just all of the complex numbers, so that A minus lambda I is not invertible. But we don't mean that like as operators on some Hilbert space. There's no Hilbert spaces inside it. This is just in some abstract algebra that happens to be. Okay. You can define the spectrum, and you can in fact define a holomorphic functional calculus. So not continuous functions, but just holomorphic functions. And it's actually pretty easy to do the holomorphic functional calculus. Once you know Cauchy's integral formula, you can sort of follow your nose and work out how to do that. So let's not do that. But not much else. At the level of Banach algebras, there's sort of not a whole lot to prove. One of the very few things you can do is make a definition, and we'll use this a few times later when we get onto C-star algebras and other things. A character on a Banach algebra is an algebra homomorphism from the algebra to the complex numbers. Okay, that's what character usually means. So, in particular, if you forget that it, remember an algebra in particular, a Banach algebra in particular is a Banach space. An algebra homomorphism in particular is just a linear map. So, in particular, these are all linear functionals. So, all the characters live in a dual. Okay. So we can topologize these by pointwise convergence. The weak star topology. We think of the characters as elements of a dual. We're topologizing them according to pointwise convergence. That's exactly the weak star topology. Okay. So. People use different symbols, but this topological space of characters, which I'll write as delta A for now, is not too hard to see, is actually compact Hausdorff. You do need to do a little bit of work here to see that you can find characters that separate points in order to show that it's... Actually, it's easy to show that it's Hausdorff. This was we actually talked about this earlier about the weak star topology. So. Anyway, the thing that I wanted to say about it is there's this thing called called the Gelfand transform. It's kind of amazing, although kind of not, because it's so simple. You've always never added gamma. And what it does is it starts from your algebra and goes to continuous functions on the character space. And it does this in a really stupid way. It just takes an algebra element, and now I've got to define a function. So I'll tell you the value of this function on a character, and the value on a character is evaluate that character at that algebra element. Okay, nice and easy. And easily, this is an algebra homomorphism. But for a general Banach algebra, you can't really say much more about this map, whether it's injective or surjective or anything like that. In general, it's just some map. But we're about to start making our algebras nicer, and this Gelfand transform will become nicer and more important. Okay, so let's have our next sort of algebra. C star algebra is, well, I'm going to give two definitions, and their famous theorem says that these are the same definition, but it's worse to do this. So the first definition is that it's a Banach algebra. Star is doing nothing. Antilinear just means you expect it sums, and it takes multiplying by complex numbers to multiplying by the complex conjugate of that complex number. So that this star has to interact with the norm, and has to interact with it in the following way. Okay. And this thing is called the C star condition. Okay. So that might seem a little bit strange, but something to notice is that, B of H still satisfies this condition, and continuous functions on a compact Hausdorff space where the norm is the supernorm also satisfy this condition. Okay. So it's not so obvious. And then definition two is a star subalgebra of B of H, closed in the strong topology. Now, it's pretty easy to see that definition two implies definition one, just because if you I'm just confused because the argument I was about to give was too good. I was about to say that any star subalgebra of B of H seems you got this. The point is that this holds just because it holds at B of H. Okay, it holds everywhere in B of H. So why do I need close to the strong topology here? Am I missing something? Certainly what we need to do is make sure that maybe what I'm missing here is that the subalgebra, either these are the same thing. Oh, dear. Okay. Let's write just closer to the normal topology. But I think that the reason I'm getting confused is that it's the same as saying that it's closer to the strong topology. But don't quote me on that. I might be being an idiot. Okay, and then you can see why you need closed in the norm topology, just so that this subalgebra still counts as a Banach space by itself. If it was some non-closed set, it might not be complete. Okay, so let's give one more example, which is sort of more obviously seen in this side, which is you can look at the compact operator. If you remember ages and ages ago, right at the beginning of the course, we proved this, that a normal bit of compact operators is still compact. So it is, that is closed in the norm topology. Now, this direction is hard, and this is what's called the Gelfand-Neimark theorem. And I'll sketch the proof in a moment, but roughly the idea is that you've got to take some abstract Banach algebra sitting out there that happens to satisfy this condition, and you've got to show that there's a Hilbert space that it's acting on to get from here to here, okay? To see that you can realize an abstract C-star algebra as a concrete one by finding a Hilbert space that it acts on faithfully. Okay, so coming back to the Gelfand transform, there's this amazing fact. Let's just leave the Gelfand transform there for a moment. Is that any commutative C-star algebra is actually just isomorphic to C of delta A, in particular isomorphic to continuous functions on some compact Hausdorff space, but we can pin down exactly which one it is, via the Gelfand transform. Maybe something I should have said first down here or somewhere. So for a C-star algebra, the Gelfand transform is actually injective. No, sorry. What am I saying? So how does this work? Well, actually, let's not say how it works, but say a special case that we do know about. If A is singly generated, now you might wonder what on earth that means, i.e. A is the smallest C-star algebra. Some specified self-adjoint X. Okay, so you think of some particular operator X, and we think about the smallest C-star algebra that could contain it. So certainly we're going to contain all polynomials in X, because an algebra lets you form polynomials, and we also have all of the and we have to have all of the limits of those polynomials as well, because of because it's meant to be a C-star algebra. Okay, so that's what it means to be singly generated. Then the functional calculus, which remember was a sort of map back the other way, went from continuous functions on the spectrum of X, and it went to our algebra. This is the inverse. Gelfand transform. So you can show in this case that the spectrum of that particular X is the same thing as the characters, and these two maps, this guy and the functional calculus, are actually the two sides of this isomorphism. Now, there's no reason why a commutative C-star algebra has to be generated by a single guy, so you have to work a little bit harder to really prove this, to prove this theorem in general. You can't just show that these two maps are inverses of each other after you've identified those two spaces. But it's not that much more work. Okay, so what's the... the slogan version of this theorem is that a C-star algebra is... a non-commutative topological space. So the idea is that we take all of our C-star algebras and we pretend that they are actually continuous functions on some topological space, even though the topological space doesn't exist. It's like we've, we write down everything we know about the algebra of continuous functions on a topological space, and what we find is that we've written down exactly the axioms for a C-star algebra, except there's one extra item. A is commutative, because point-wise multiplication to functions is commutative, so we just cross that one off the list, and we think of this algebra as being the functions on some imaginary space that can't possibly exist, because otherwise if the space existed, the algebra would be commutative. We do that. Okay. This slogan will become really important in just a moment, because this is really the whole idea of quantum mechanics in a second. We're going to do von Neumann algebras and measure theory, and non-commutative measure theory is quantum mechanics. Okay, so let's have von Neumann algebras. Okay, and again, I'm going to give a bunch of definitions, although I'm not even going to come close to indicating why they're the same, because these are all kind of hard theorems. So first of all, we can have a weakly closed star subalgebra of B of H. And so you might think of this definition as sort of a concrete von Neumann algebra. It's given to you as an algebra of operators. Okay. But then there are two different I guess this one's kind of concrete as well. So let's say the second definition is a star closed subset of B of H. So star closed just means stars of things are still in the set. There's nothing about topology. So that A double prime equals A. So do you know what A double prime should mean here? What about A prime? Have people seen the idea of commutants in the... I guess in group theory they're called centralizers. Okay, so here, for any set X, so if X is just some subset of B of H, X prime is defined to be all of the operators T in B of H, such that ST equals TS for all S in X. Okay? So that's just called the commutant. Okay? It's everything that commutes with everything in X. And so there's an actual inclusion of X into X double prime. You obviously commute with everything that commutes with you. So you automatically get that. And we can characterize von Neumann algebras as sets with that property, that that actually that inclusion is everything. Okay, that everything that commuted with everything that commuted with you is already inside of you. That's the condition. So it's pretty easy to see that even if just X is some arbitrary set, X prime is a vector space. You can take two things, T, or T and T1 and T2 that commute with everything here, and their sum will commute with everything here, similarly scalars. It's even an algebra right away. as soon as you take the first commutation. If you've got two things, T1 and T prime, both of which commute with S, then product commutes with S as well. So even though sort of this guy could have just been a set, this thing's always going to be some algebra. And so this is why this definition actually gives you things that are algebras. Okay. And then the third one is just as an abstract C star algebra. So no Hilbert spaces inside. Remember that was just a Banach algebra satisfying the C star condition. With Banach space pre-dual. I thought of just as a Banach space, forgetting everything else. It is the dual of some other Banach space. Okay? Remember that in general for a Banach space, like every Banach space has a dual, but there are plenty of Banach spaces that aren't the dual of some other Banach space. So I don't care so much about this version of the definition. It's just there because some operator algebraists like to be able to think about von Neumann algebras without pinning themselves down to thinking about a particular Hilbert space it's acting on. And it's quite a deep theorem that every algebra satisfying this crazy condition can actually be made to act on a Hilbert space. And so, for that matter, I don't even know right now how you show that these conditions give you a pre-dual. Yeah. Okay. So lots of crazy ways of doing it, but this is the definition you probably should think about mostly. It's just a weakly closed subalgebra of B of H. And so remember, of course, that weakly closed certainly means that you're closed in the norm topology, because it's a weaker topology. So von Neumann algebras are C-star algebras, okay? So certainly we have von Neumann implies C-star implies Banach. Okay, so that means we're going down to smaller and smaller classes of algebras, but you should think of von Neumann algebras as being much bigger than C-star algebras, because they've also got all their weak limits, as well as just all their norm limits. And then the theorem, the example first. Well, there's always our favorite B of H. There's L infinity of X. For any measure space X. And here I just wanted to stop and think about what's going on for a second. If you've got a measure space, so that's a set, a sigma algebra, and a measure, how much does L infinity actually depend on all that data? Does it actually depend on the measure? If I change the measure, yeah, but leave this, so how does it change?
The essential. What's it called? The norm.
Yeah, so L infinity, for one, the norm is the essential supremum. Another way of thinking about it is that L infinity of X is the equivalence classes of functions that differ on null sets. But really, L infinity of X, you might say, depends on something slightly weaker, like it's the triple, the set, the sigma algebra, and the collection of null sets. It can't really tell the difference between two measures if they have the same null set. So it's a bit of a weird thing. But you need more than just the sigma algebra to talk about L infinity. Let's have one more example. R has a bit of a scary name, the hyperfinite 2-1 factor. So a factor is a von Neumann algebra with trivial center. It's just a bit of terminology, so now you know what factor means. But let me tell you roughly at least the definition of this guy. Let's say I take the complex numbers, and I can embed that diagonally in 2x2 matrices, okay? And then I can embed that diagonally in 4x4 matrices. So here, like A, B, C, D is going to A, B, C, D, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay? So on. And we do this infinitely many times. R is in some sense the co-limit of this. So what I'm saying is that you can take an element of any of these matrix algebras, and you're allowed to think of it as an element of R. But if I take some element here in the 2x2 matrices, I quotient out by saying the element I think of here in the 2x2 matrices is the same thing as the sort of blown up version of it I would have got in the 4x4 matrices by embedding the diagonal. So it's like a union of all of these things quotiented out by all these inclusions along the diagonal.
So you tensor the identity a lot.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's saying that sort of some matrix of some fixed size tensored with the identity however many times sort of is the same thing as what we started with. And let's not talk about that one anymore. And you need to be a little bit careful about this. I mean, the problem is not every element of R is not really a co-limit in the sense that not every element of R is actually realized by one of these. But it's pretty easy to see that this is a norm-preserving map. Like, the largest eigenvalue of this guy is the same as the largest eigenvalue of that guy. What we're doing is we're taking this sort of this limit of all of these guys, and then we've got to remember to complete it. It wasn't complete. So there are points sitting outside that aren't realized by any finite matrix. Okay, but that's a crazy example of a von Neumann algebra that's very, very far from this sort of example. In fact, very far from that one, but we can't really say why. The theorem, like the theorem in the C star algebra world, is any commutative von Neumann algebra. Is L infinity of x for some x. Okay? So, modulo this funny business about the measure not quite mattering, but the null sets do matter, the slogan should be von Neumann algebras are non commutative measure spaces. Okay. So, now it's time for, I think, the quantum mechanics basically. So the point is that people used to think that measure spaces were good for talking about uncertain information about the real world, probability spaces, they're calculating probabilities. And the surprising discovery of last century was that you're not meant to use commutative measure spaces to talk about the real world. You're meant to use non-commutative measure spaces to talk about the real world, but otherwise everything is the same as it was back in 1900. So let's try and show a few examples of this. We need one more definition from operator algebra world. So a state, phi, on a C-star algebra. Remember, von Neumann algebras are C-star algebras too, so we really care about states on von Neumann algebras, but we'll define it in generality. A is a positive linear functional phi from A to the complex numbers. And let's further ask one more thing, that phi of 1, that's the, maybe I should write the identity, right? Whatever, 1, the identity in the algebra, is the complex number. Okay. Now, this word state is really, really in a moment going to mean state. It's like the state of the universe is a state. But we're going to have to give some interpretation before that makes sense. Okay. Let me say a bit of this even though it's not about quantum mechanics quite yet. So say we've got pi. Representation of a C star algebra A. So here we mean a star algebra homomorphism into B of H. So every operator is now an operator acting on a Hilbert space. So every element of the C star algebra is being sent to some operator on a Hilbert space. Well, then we can, if we've got some vector xi in the Hilbert space, it's pretty easy to check that if you look at the map that sends A, an element of the algebra, to the inner product of pi of a actuon it or actuon xi in a product with xi is a state. So what do we need to check? So you should have complained maybe. What does positive mean here on a C star algebra? What does a positive linear functional mean? So on B of H, what does it mean for a functional to be positive? You've got to be a little bit careful, because remember a C star algebra might just be this general abstract C star algebra with no Hilbert spaces inside. So we have to be a little careful. We can't talk about inner products in general. Yeah. So x in A is positive if x equals y star y for some y. Okay. Now, if you've got that and you look in some representation, now if you're acting on some Hilbert space, which wasn't necessarily the definition, but then it's easy to see that we're positive in the sort of B of H sense, because then of course this is just y xi, okay? But this definition makes perfect sense in the abstract world with no Hilbert spaces inside. Okay, so now we know what a positive element of a C-star algebra is. What's a positive linear functional?
So take them to positive?
Exactly, yeah, it just takes positive operators to non-negative. Great, so here, this thing here is obviously a linear functional. It's obviously linear in A. Pi is a linear map. And if A is of the form y star y, then we can stick y star y in there. We can use the fact that pi is a star algebra homomorphism to turn that into pi of y star times pi of y, and then we move the pi of y star over. Because now that star really means adjoint in the Hilbert space sense, inevitably. So it counts as a state. And of course, we should be taking the identity here to the identity here. So pi of the identity is just, so we better ask that xi is a unit vector if we want to get an actual state. Okay, these are called vector states. And the fantastic theorem I guess it's really the Gelfand-Neimark-Siegel construction. I'm not going to prove it, but this is what goes into the proof that every abstract C-star algebra can be thought of as a bunch of operators on Hilbert space. It's really this. You can show that for every state, there exists a Hilbert space and a representation. And a vector xi in that Hilbert space. Let's call this state phi sub xi, because it was a state depending on the vector we chose there. So our original state is the state induced by that. So actually, every abstract state in this sense really is a vector state. There's some Hilbert space out there, so it's like this. So here, in a moment when I start saying that states are real physical things describing the state of the universe, this suddenly explains the totally mysterious fact that the physicists will tell you that the universe is described by some Hilbert space when you do quantum mechanics. There's some Hilbert space there that you move around in and so on. And that's in some sense just nonsense. I mean, you can do that, but it's just a shadow of the real thing. What's really going on is there's some C-star algebra describing the universe, and the state of the universe is a state in this sense. And if you want to, but you don't have to, you may, by this theorem, interpret that state as there being some Hilbert space out there, and your algebra is acting by bounded operators on that Hilbert space, and your state is just this guy. But you don't need to, okay? The Hilbert spaces are entirely optional, contrary to what the physicists say. This is really what's going on in the world, okay? We live in a giant C-star algebra, And right now, the universe is a positive linear functional. Okay. How are we going for time? Okay. Let me try and justify a little bit of this why states are states. Let's just go through three examples that hopefully will explain all of quantum mechanics. okay. So, okay. So let's just take A to be C2. I mean, just the algebra C direct sum C. So multiplication is just pointwise multiplication. And let's just really spell out everything that's going on here. So a state, phi, well, it's got no choice but to look like this, AZ plus BW. And then, of course, the identity in A is just the vector 1, 1. Okay? So that's A plus B. So that has to equal 1. Okay? Oh, well, maybe I should just say here A and B are just arbitrary complex numbers so far. But now we know the sum is 1. It's easy to see that these guys are positive. These guys are actually self-adjoint and equal to their own square, so that says they're positive. And of course, phi of 1, 0 is just A, so that's going to be a non-negative real number, and similarly, B is a non-negative real number. Those conditions actually characterize positivity. That's a little exercise. If you just have A and B non-negative real numbers, you stick in any positive element. Well, positive elements are just, of course, vectors, both of whose elements are positive numbers. You get something positive. Okay, so we've completely characterized what the states look like. They're just a pair of real numbers whose sum is 1. Okay, so the state space is just, here we go, just this little interval in C2, R2. Okay, great. Let's massively generalize that. Oh, and of course, I mean, how do we interpret this in terms of the real world? This algebra is the algebra you use to describe. Does one have a coin in their pocket? It's the algebra you use to describe a two-state system. Okay, I flip the coin. Throw me a coin. Come on. Okay. So I flip the coin. Where in our state space is the universe right now?
It's 9.5.
It's sitting there right in the middle there. I look at it, and it's tails. And suddenly, the wave function collapses, and our state jumps from here to here. Okay, we know it's definitely tails now. Okay, that's all that's happening. We say the wave function collapses. Okay, you can get your 20 cents back in a moment. Okay. So let's do a massive generalization of that example. Let's just let A be continuous functions on a compact Hausdorff space. Okay. What are states? This is the whole point of the middle of the course. A state on C of X is just a positive linear functional on the continuous functions on X. States are exactly Radon measures. Okay, because remember, the positive linear functionals on C of X are just the measures on X. Oh, but we've got one more condition. We need that phi of the identity function is 1. That's just saying that the integral of the constant function is 1, so they're Radon probability measures. Okay, so here, secretly, this algebra is, of course, just continuous functions on two points, heads and tails. For an arbitrary commutative C-star algebra, the states are just probability measures on the set of underlying points of the space that were continuous functions. Okay, so when we stay in the commutative world, states are just probability distributions on the underlying state, on the underlying space. Okay. Let's now try and go to the real world. Let's just look at 2x2 matrices. So this is, I feel like in the interest of time, maybe I'll skip the derivation, but it's completely elementary. You can go through this and just work out what it means to be a state. And obviously positive linear functionals means you just start by writing down four complex numbers. And then you check what positivity means, and you'd have to do some work there. And you need to check what phi of 1 going to 1 is. And I've written this down, in fact, because I wrote this down for the talk I gave a year ago. But it's in there. I wrote some notes for today, and they're on my webpage if people want to be able to look at this later. So let's just say it. A state, we've been using phi of wxyz, following kind of complicated looking thing, where alpha, beta, gamma are real numbers, inside the unit ball of R3. Okay, so this is some derivation, and you've got to go and understand what the positive linear functionals on 2x2 matrices are. But it turns out they all look exactly like this, parameterized by here. So our state space is the solid unit ball. Sitting inside of. Okay, so fine, that's a bit interesting. Let's notice a few things. I guess we can remove this slide down. So I just really want to show that this is very different from the commutative case. To describe an extremal state is a state is not a convex linear combo of other states. So remember, all of our states, in particular, are linear functionals. So they sit in a dual, which is some Banach space. So it makes sense to talk about linear combinations of states. Okay, and you can ask whether one is a convex linear combination of other ones. So remember, in our heads and tails example, the extremal states are those 2 points at the end, and all the arbitrary states are in between. Okay, so the extremal states were what a classical-minded person would have said are the real states of the universe. The coin is either heads or tails. But we have to give up on that a little bit, and just distinguish those as the extremal states amongst all states which are equally good. In the probability measure case, can you describe some extremal states for me? It's a little bit harder here to pin down exactly what's going on, but one example of an extremal state is just a Dirac measure that just is at a single point. That's extremal. And that's sort of the classically minded thing, like saying the system is really at this exact state. In practice, it's a little bit more complicated to say, unfortunately, those aren't all of the extremal states. There are a few more. So the Krein-Milman theorem, which is just a corollary of Banach-Alloglu that we didn't quite have time to get to, it says much more general stuff, but it says all states are in the convex hull. Extremal states. And you might say that that's just a tautology. This is just the definition. I mean, remember that non-extremal states are things which were convex linear combinations of extremal ones. The worry might be when you're working in infinite dimensional examples, there might just not be any extremal states if you weren't careful. And then, of course, nothing could be in the convex hull of the extremal states because there weren't any. So Krein-Milman guarantees actually there are extremal states, and all of the states are convex linear combinations. Okay, so, but in the finite dimensional examples, that fact is obvious. So the extremal states here, in the 2x2 example, are the unit sphere.
Okay. Now, something very, very different happens, however, in the classical and quantum worlds here. Unlike in the classical world, mixed states, so mixed states, physicists will say pura instead of extremal, but it's the same word, and mixed state just means non-extremal states. Mixed states are not uniquely convex linear combinations of pure states. Okay? In our heads and tails example, every possible state was just a convex linear combination of these, and yeah, something. You can. It turns out once you pin down what all the extremal states are, that's true here as well. But here it's just absolutely not true. And I take my sphere, and I take the north and south pole of the sphere, and I take some convex linear combination, and I hit the point here. That's equally well a convex linear combination of a point here and a point here on the sides of the sphere. Okay. So while it was possible in the classical world to pretend that there was an actual universe out there, which could only be in the extremal states, and all the other states just represented our uncertainty about the world, which we expressed by writing as convex linear combinations of the things that were real, it doesn't exactly make sense to do that anymore. If the universe is in this state, you could either say, well, we're 50% sure it's there or 50% sure it's there, or you could say we're 60% sure it's here and 40% sure it's here. And those both give you exactly the same state of the universe that is completely indistinguishable as a state. So, I mean, it doesn't make sense to say those are two different descriptions of the world. And, I mean, if there are dragons in quantum mechanics, it's essentially in this picture here, in this fact that mixed states can be written in different ways as convex linear combinations. Okay. I think we've got 2 more minutes, so let me just very quickly so there's some further lovely stuff that goes on here so we can talk about a projection. Our algebra is just an element x, so x squared is x, and x star is x. And I guess I can't do this justice in a short amount of time. And these things are meant to correspond to Boolean observables in the real world, questions you can ask about your state that have yes and no answers. It's easy to see in this world that the projections, well, you really should go up to all of, to do this properly, we should actually go to the von Neumann algebra, the von Neumann algebra completion of this, all L infinity functions. Then the projections there are exactly just the characteristic functions of sets. And so the Boolean questions you're asking just, do you lie in this set or do you not? And you can write very nice formulas that just follow in a very sensible way that I wish I had time to explain about how states should be updated after you ask Boolean questions of your system. And you can just see that in the classical case, it corresponds to basically conditional expectations, and in the quantum case, it corresponds to what physicists describe as what happens when you
when you measure a self-adjoint operator on a Hilbert space, and they're actually just the same formulas from the state formalism, and the formula is essentially Bayes' theorem about how you update probabilities based on observations. But it's from the perspective about states and monomial algebras, Bayes' theorem and how wave functions change after observations are exactly the same formula, with non-commutative or non-commutative algebras. And I had a nice example in the 2x2 matrices of how this works. I mean, a really cool thing, maybe just about these Boolean questions, is just that in the classical world here, there exist states so that every projection has a definite answer, either gives you 0 or 1. And it's very easy to see that you can characterize non-commutative Riemann algebras as just being ones that there exists some state, it says that the algebra is non-commutative exactly if there are no states, so that all Boolean observables have definite answers. You can just see that. That's a characterization of the algebra being non-commutative. Okay, we probably better stop there. I'm out of time yet again. Cool. Okay. I wanted to say one more thing. This, maybe everyone already knows this, but I feel like I should, at the end of a third year class, tell everyone who is not already doing honors at the moment, or about to be doing honors, that you should come and do honours, and you should talk to Joan and sign up to do honours at some point, because all of you should be doing it. Done. Yeah, that applies to you guys too on the video recording.